Election Day 2014. Polls have just closed in Iowa, Montana, Nevada, and Utah. There are only 7 states where voting is still going on. I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff. At stake, control of the United States Senate. Republicans need to pick up 6 seats to claim a majority, and they have already won 3, half of what they need.
Republicans will retain their lock on the House of Representatives. There are gubernatorial contests in 36 states. Pre-election polling indicated tight contests across the board.
Stay with us online throughout the rest of this evening for analysis and the latest results. We'll also have a special report on air and online at 11 p.m. Eastern.
It's election night on the PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Lincoln Financial, committed to helping you take charge of your life and become your own chief life officer.
BNSF Railway. And by BAE Systems, inspired work.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. And by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Republicans are building momentum tonight in their drive to capture control of the Senate. So far, they've now taken 4 of the 6 seats they need. In Montana, Steve Daines is the projected winner. In Arkansas, where Congressman Tom Cotton defeated incumbent Democrat Mark Pryor. In West Virginia, where Shelley Moore Capito won the seat being vacated by Democratic Senator Jay Rockefeller, who's retiring. And in South Dakota, Republican Mike Rounds is the projected winner. A number of key Senate races in Georgia, North Carolina, Virginia, and New Hampshire remain too close to call. In governor's races, Democrats have won a Republican seat in Pennsylvania, where Tom Wolf defeated incumbent Tom Corbett, but Republican Asa Hutchinson captured an open seat in Arkansas that had been held by Democrats. With us now, Stu Rothenberg and Amy Walter, who maybe can help us figure out why all of this is happening and what states we're still waiting on, starting with you, Amy.
Oh, I have to explain why everything is happening. Yes, it's I think what we're seeing right now is nothing out of the ordinary. We're seeing, as you pointed out, a lot of these red states that we had talked about earlier, the West Virginia, South Dakota, Arkansas, Montana, going to Republicans, not unexpected at all. The good news for Democrats is they held on to New Hampshire, which is one of those states that was closing at the end. So right now it looks like Republicans netting 4 seats, but the map as we continue to move west is going to be tough for Republicans. They still have to be able, the map's still going to be tough for Democrats. Right. They have to be able to hold on to Montana, which is almost impossible, Iowa, Colorado, and then finally Alaska. So the map's still somewhat uphill as we get into these red and purple states moving west.
Yeah, so far the only surprise to me is that Virginia continues to be close, that Ed Gillespie is holding on or has been holding on to a very narrow lead over Mark Warner. Amy and I have been looking at various counties that have not yet completed their reporting. Looks to us that they probably give Warner an advantage, but the race is close. But otherwise, when you look at the southern states, the red states, they've gone Republican, and the Democrats, as Amy said, have held on to New Hampshire. North Carolina looks close, maybe with a slight advantage to Democrat Kay Hagan. And we have a whole bunch of other close races, Kansas Senate and governor's races, the Wisconsin governor's race. So other than Virginia, I wish, Gwen, I could tell you that I'm shocked, stunned, and can't explain
and
anything. But our ratings are kind of holding on these statewide races.
Mm. Judy?
Well, and, you know, Mark Shields is sitting here with me. We're talking about those races that we still don't know. And you've been marveling. I have to say, you've been looking at the age factor. You've been looking at the gender factor. And I don't know, maybe some other secrets you have up your sleeve as you look at these. Let me see what. As you look at these exit polls. But can we, you know, can we really tell by one night, one midterm, whether a party is shifting in its appeal to women or men or older or younger?
No, but a pattern does emerge. You recall after 2004 and President Bush's reelection, we were convinced in the pundit class that there was a permanent Republican majority. And then after 2008 and President Obama's smashing Democratic victory and capturing all these new states, that there was obviously an emerging Democratic locked-in permanent majority. I think what we're seeing is that, just as Amy and Stu made the point, that the Republicans are picking up states that the Republicans had to pick up and should have picked up. I mean, the real mystery is, why did the Democrats have seats in South Dakota? Why did the Democrats have Senate seats in Montana? These are states that have become, especially Montana, increasingly Republican over the years. And, we talked about West Virginia. West Virginia has changed, the whole footing of West Virginia has changed from Rockefeller to Shelley Moore Capito.
You know, one of the states that's closing this hour is Iowa, where right. Tom Harkin, stalwart of the Senate, is retiring, a Democrat. Yep. And right now, we haven't called that race yet. We're waiting to see what happens. But favored going into the night was the Republican Joni Ernst.
Yes. And I think this does prove the importance of candidates. I mean, Joni Ernst surprised, I think, even her strongest supporters by being a superior candidate. I mean, she had a wonderful warmth about her. She had a great theme in the campaign about Iowa values, that she embodied them. And I think her military credential, the fact that she had served on active duty in the Afghanistan, I think gave her a special credibility.
She was quite the package.
She really was. And Bruce Braley made a serious mistake, and that's something that, before a group of trial lawyers in Texas at a fundraiser, he said, if the Republicans win control of the Senate, that means the chairman of the Judiciary Committee will be a farmer from Iowa who never went to law school.
But you know, it should also be said that the first time I ever heard of Joni Ernst was when Sarah Palin endorsed her and lifted her out of obscurity.
No question. Gave her a lift and gave her an energy in the primary.
But I have to say, I was lucky to be invited to moderate a debate among the Republican candidates back in the spring. Joni Ernst at that time stood out among the Republicans. But we don't know yet. The polls aren't closed in Iowa. So money. If this was the most expensive election in our history, you can bet a lot of that money was spent on advertising. Our political director Domenico Montanaro has been keeping an eye on what has been saturating the airwaves and even online.
If you live in a state with a close Senate race, you're probably really glad it's Election Day, because that means no more political ads.
Your health plan canceled.
Mitch is at the heart of everything that's wrong in Washington.
More than $1 billion was spent on TV ads in 2014, more than any other midterm election ever. Most of them attack ads like that. And if you live in a place like Iowa, with one of the most hotly contested Senate races, you've seen more than 60,000 ads just since this summer. Republicans' main target? President Obama.
In 2008, I fell in love. But by 2012, our relationship was in trouble. But I stuck with him because he promised he'd be better. He's great at promises.
And tying Democratic senators to him.
Pryor. O-B-A-M-A.
Close enough.
More money was spent on healthcare ads than any other issue. Most against.
Promises that weren't true. Mary Landrieu cast the deciding vote for Obamacare.
Some defending.
Because if Congress repeals Obamacare, insurance companies would go back to charging whatever they want.
But every week, it seemed like something new.
While ISIS grew, Obama did nothing. Senator Hagan did cocktails.
She's for amnesty, while terrorism experts say our border breakdown could provide an entry for groups like ISIS.
While Republicans tried to nationalize the election, Democrats stressed local issues.
When I'm asked who's responsible for these education cuts, it's Tom Tillis and his legislature.
At Merrill Field, where I expanded the safety zone. At Eielson, where we kept the F-16s.
Other ads aimed at breaking through had a lighter touch. They went to those classic political ad props, animals.
I grew up castrating hogs on an Iowa farm. So when I get to Washington, I'll know how to cut pork.
Our tax dollars were spent studying how monkeys respond to unfairness and how they act while on cocaine.
So when I get to Washington, I'll stand up to the big spenders.
Babies.
Help me change the childish behavior up there.
And even pop culture.
Gary Peters' Lone Sharknado.
Whatever the message, candidates hope their ads can help reassure.
I never stopped fighting for my daughter, and Mitch never stopped fighting for us.
Or plant a seed of doubt.
Can we
really trust Terry Lynn Land to do what's right for Michigan?
And motivate their voters to tip the balance in their favor.
You can hardly believe some of those ads. And let's go right now to Domenico, our political director, and to our political editor, Lisa Desjardins. Domenico, fill us in on where some of these races are. We've been waiting to find out what's happened.
Okay, so let's go to the scorecard. And right now we see it's 46-42 Republicans. They need four more seats overall. But what we've seen in the flip so far, they've gotten plus four. And we know the magic number for tonight is plus six for them for seats that they need to take over for a majority. And there's a couple seats in this hour that we're still looking at to wondering where are we going with those races. Colorado for one. Iowa, another, and we're still, of course, waiting on Virginia, which is very close, North Carolina, which is very close, still haven't gotten those in, and we could get those all very quickly, and we have to be ready here in the next hour to see where all those go.
We're also looking at ballot initiatives across the country. Lisa, you've been keeping a close eye. Are we learning anything yet?
Yes, you know I love these ballot initiatives. I think they are very important. On marijuana, it looks like the District of Columbia, this is no surprise, will overwhelmingly vote in favor of trying to legalize marijuana possession, 1 ounce. It's not a big surprise. That could get tangled up with Congress later on. Let's look at Florida, where there was a closer race over the battle of marijuana. Florida, on their ballot, the idea of allowing medical marijuana use. Right now, that's at 57%, a majority of the state going for it, but it requires 60% to become law. So it looks like Florida right now is not likely to pass that, but we'll see what happens through the night. Also, abortion is on several ballots this year. Let's talk about Colorado, where we're seeing some results as well. Right now, the Colorado Abortion Initiative, which would define life as beginning at an early stage of conception and also penalize anyone who, for example, a drunk driver who kills a pregnant woman's baby, that right now is losing. This would be the third time such an amendment would be failing in Colorado. And finally, let's talk about minimum wage in Arkansas. There you see the five states that are proposing minimum wage amendments this year. Arkansas right now, minimum wage increase is winning. We're waiting for results on one other interesting Arkansas initiative, Gwen and Judy. You know, Arkansas has 37 dry counties, and they're voting tonight on whether, essentially, they should repeal prohibition. So I'll give you an update on that as soon as I have one.
Interesting about minimum wage in particular. Yeah. In Arkansas, a state we think of as Republican, they've elected a Republican to the Senate. Tonight kicked out their Democratic senator, and yet they're going for an increase in the minimum wage, which we know some Republicans are in favor of, but certainly more Democrats are.
I'd like to also add a note on Virginia. I have two brothers. One is more conservative, one is more liberal. They both live in Virginia. My more liberal brother called me two nights ago and said, hey, Mark Warner's going to win, isn't he? And I said, well, you know, the polling looks that way, who knows? And he said, okay, great, so I don't have to vote, do I? And then I said, well, maybe he's not going to win. I don't know. So maybe there's some of that going on with Mark Warner that he was assumed he would win and people didn't show up. Who knows?
And that's something I think that happens in a lot of races. People assume an outcome and they think their vote doesn't count. But Gwen, every vote counts.
Every vote counts. I'm really interested in that anti-prohibition lifting back in Arkansas. We'll get back to that later. But in the meantime, we're going to go up to the newsroom to Hari Srinivasan, who's been talking to reporters about what's happening on the ground around the country. Hari?
Thanks, Gwen. We're headed to Kansas first. Elahi Izadi is a political reporter with the Washington Post. She joins us tonight from the Topeka campaign headquarters of Republican Senator Pat Roberts. So what's the mood there at this point in the evening?
Well, we just heard a loud roar from that room, but it was for a state treasurer who just won re-election. So right now we're still waiting to see what's going to happen with Governor Brownback and Senator Pat Roberts. The governor is also in a tight re-election race. And actually, just a few minutes ago, the Senate state president was talking about how we're in for a really long night and that Senator Roberts has run an anti-incumbent year. So it doesn't sound all too optimistic, but they are expecting here to be very late.
Okay, I think the latest numbers that we have is that Roberts is leading about 50-46. And why is he in so much danger? Why has he had trouble holding on to Republicans?
Well, he's kind of got a two-front war going, right? In August, he survived a very tough primary battle, but coming out of that, he kind of alienated a lot of conservatives. A lot of conservatives weren't on board with him. And going out of that, then in September, the Democratic Senate candidate, Chad Taylor, dropped out of the race, and that left the door wide open for this independent Greg Orman to run against Senator Roberts. Now, at the same time, you've got this governor's race, and in the governor's race, it's going to be tight. They're fighting over Republican voters, these Republican moderates, who many of whom are upset with the governor, and now Senator Roberts has kind of become vulnerable on both of these fronts. Added on top of that, there's just the sentiment around the state that he's lost touch with Kansas. So he's really entering a really tough fight. Recent weeks, the polls have been kind of neck and neck, and it's really anyone's game at this point. But we'll be paying attention to the returns. There's some high population counties that still haven't reported fully.
And what about Greg Orman? What was their strategy today or in the past couple of days going into the home stretch?
Well, this independent Greg Orman, remember, he can't rely on a traditional party infrastructure to get out the vote the way Senator Pat Roberts could. So really what they were focusing on was turning out independent, unaffiliated voters who tend to vote in presidential years but not in midterms. So they're trying to turn out voters who don't usually turn out this time of year. In addition, the Republicans are running their Get Out the Vote campaign, and so are Democrats in the state running it for their candidate for governor. So both of those entities are doing what they're doing, and meanwhile, Orman's really zeroing in on these independents.
All right. Ilahi Izadi with The Washington Post joining us from Topeka tonight. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
All right, back to you, Gwen.
Thanks, Hari. You know, we've been talking about the Senate. We've been talking about governor's races. But, you know, every single member of the House of Representatives is up for re-election tonight. So I'm going to go back to Stu and Amy and ask them for a little what they're seeing, what kind of tea leaves they're reading on the key House races. Stu, what are you seeing?
Well, we're seeing a handful of holds and flips that are not unexpected, but again, reinforce the general sense that the Republicans have a bit of momentum. I'll just pick a couple races out of... Well, let's look at West Virginia 3. This is Nick Rahal's race. It is a southern race in West Virginia, a coal country Democratic race. Rahal's numbers have been dropping little by little over the years, but the Democrats thought he could hang on again. Evan Jenkins is a former Democratic legislator who switched parties, is now the Republican, and it looks like he is winning that West Virginia race. Again, coal antipathy toward the president. That's a pickup for the Republicans. And in the Virginia suburbs, Virginia's 10th congressional district, just outside of Washington, D.C., Fairfax, Loudoun counties, this is a Republican open seat where moderate conservative Frank Wolf is retiring. Barbara Comstock, a conservative Republican, certainly there's no doubt about that, but the more moderate Republican in a Republican primary ends up holding on this seat in a district that in a difficult environment for Republicans probably would have gone Democratic, but in this environment with these voters, it looks like Comstock has held it for the Republicans.
And I'll just give a bit of the good news side for the Democrats. Florida in the 2nd Congressional District, which is somewhat of a even Republican-leaning swing district, very, very difficult kind of district for Democrats. But Democrats have picked up that seat, defeating a Republican incumbent, Steve Sutherland. The story is Gwen Graham. She is the daughter of the former senator, Bob Graham, and has run probably one of the most impressive races of any House candidate.
This is another indication that candidates matter.
Yeah.
Gwen Graham is a terrific candidate, energetic, enthusiastic, hardworking.
Plus her name is Gwen, right?
Of course. that's what tilted
that's
it,
what did it
the whole time. And then one other race that is interesting to point out, you know, while Republicans winning in those red states, coal country, where Democrats still doing well is up in blue states, Massachusetts 6. This was a very, very close race in the 2012 election. And it looks like Seth Moulton, who is a really impressive candidate, beat the sitting incumbent in a primary, Democratic incumbent, defeating the Republican there, Richard Desai, who, if he would have been elected, would have been openly gay Republican member, still shows that even when you have a moderate, Republican, openly gay, how difficult it is to win in a state like Massachusetts.
Well, thanks, guys. We're going to come back here to the anchor desk because Judy has a little bit of news.
I do, and it is a pickup for the Republicans, Gwen. In the state of Colorado, we are ready to project that Cory Gardner, the Republican, will win that Senate seat, taking it away from Mark Udall, who was seeking his second term in the United States Senate. Mr. Udall, Senator Udall, the son of the late Congressman Mo Udall of New Mexico. You could say there's a Udall dynasty. There's another Udall who is currently the senator from New Mexico. But this is a big pickup for the Republicans. Mark Shields. It's one that has the Democrats crying over, I would assume.
Absolutely. Colorado is a state that twice has voted for President Obama, and the Democrats are feeling the demographics of it were just absolutely in the Democrats' favor. The biggest growth area in the country for people under the age of 35 moving to was the Denver metropolitan area. I mean, there was just a sense that this was a happening place and a place that only Democrats would do better in. And Cory Gardner really threw a monkey wrench into those plans.
And I was in Colorado a couple of weeks ago covering that race, and it was interesting having conversations with both of them because Cory Gardner is obviously very smooth, very skilled politician, but also a former member of the House.
That's right.
Mark Udall didn't seem to see this coming. I think he was a little surprised at all of this.
I think he did it, and I wonder. I mean, Michael Bennett, who did win that same seat,
the other
senator from Colorado. You just wonder if that wasn't, in fact, sort of a false spring that you could put that coalition together and run on the on cultural social issues. Mark Udall ran away from the president. You recall the president did an event for him in Denver, a fundraiser, and he said no, he was going to stay back here because there was an important vote on confirmation of the of Secretary Castro at HUD, who was being confirmed by a vote of 80-10, I think. It was a real cliffhanger. So it was a little bit of the same problem that Kentucky
One of many examples this election cycle.
We have a little bit more news. It turns out that in Wisconsin tonight, we can project that Florida first, I've been told, that we're going to be able to project the governor, Rick Scott, the incumbent governor, has defeated Charlie Crist, who, of course, is the Democrat who ran as was once an independent, was once a Republican, and they ran a pretty tight race. We will remember their debates in which a fan became the issue about who got to bring a fan on stage. But more importantly, Rick Scott really held on in a state that was changing, and Charlie Crist ran a tough race, but what we are projecting tonight that he has lost. Also in Wisconsin, another big governor's race we've been watching, which has implications for 2016. Scott Walker is the winner. It looks like now in Wisconsin over Mary Burke, who's a businesswoman in Wisconsin. She was very strong in the Milwaukee area and among the what we've been calling tonight the Obama coalition. But in fact, Scott Walker, who was survived a recall just a couple years ago,
you could
Judy,
call this his second recall.
His second
vote that
recall.
He survived.
And not only that, but has made no bones about his interest in running for president in a couple years.
That's right.
Rather remarkable. This is an example of a state that has become increasingly partisan and increasingly polarized. And Scott Walker, it's the first governor in American history to face a recall and to prevail and then win re-election. But it's always by the narrowest of margins.
And that's all it takes, though.
But he's the winner. He's the governor for 100% of the time, even if he wins with 49.7%.
He's been a relentless campaigner
out there, feeling
the heat.
Yep.
Well, now we want to go back to our newsroom, to Hari. He has another report from the field.
All right, we're going to return to Atlanta, Judy, in that Senate race to replace retiring Republican Saxby Chambliss. We're joined once more tonight by Celeste Headley of Georgia Public Broadcasting. So is there the possibility here that this race could turn into a runoff?
Actually, right now, it's looking like with at least 80% of counties reporting that David Perdue has 57% of the vote and Michelle Nunn has 41%. Obviously, as you probably know, that's far off of what the polls predicted. So if that ends up being a final total, there's going to be some questions asked in Georgia.
Okay, and how much, there was actually a third candidate that we didn't actually mention earlier this evening, wasn't campaigning, Amanda Swafford. Did she have an impact in this at all?
Not that we're seeing so far. She's often been less than 2% of the vote of reporting. That was predicted, though, as people saw that the race was very, very close. Many people predicted that those who said they were going to vote for the third-party candidate would actually switch their vote over to the Republican because they were nervous that the Republican might lose.
Okay, how much have the candidates focused on some of those big national issues, especially unemployment? Georgia has one of the highest unemployment rates, if not the highest, in the country.
It is the highest at this point. David Perdue certainly has tried to make this a race on national politics, and he hasn't been shy about admitting that. He's tried to make this race about Harry Reid and Barack Obama. Michelle Nunn, understandably, has tried to distance herself from the White House as much as possible. Barack Obama has a 42% approval rating here in Georgia. However, I think when most of our reporters, at least, have spoken to voters at the polls, the things that they've mentioned as being important to them have been the economy, the unemployment rate, as you mentioned, and education in this state. Not many people have mentioned the president or Harry Reid at all when they've gone to the polls today.
Okay. And where are we with the governor's race? While I've got you, I mean, did we see people cross over and switch parties voting for different candidates for different races?
No, it looks like that so far the results are showing the people voting exactly on party lines, meaning that all night long we've seen the exact same percentage of people voting for both Nathan Deal and David Perdue, the two Republican candidates, and the same number of people voting for the two Democrats as well, Michelle Nunn and Jason Carter. So this looks to be a race on turnout, how many voters each party can get to the polls rather than necessarily the individual candidates.
All right. Celeste Hadley of Georgia Public Broadcasting joining us. Thanks so much for your time.
My pleasure.
All right. Back to you, Gwen.
Thanks, Hari. And now as we creep toward that six GOP pickup number that we've been watching for all night, we'll go back to our political director, Domenico Montanaro, to see how that is shaping up. Domenico?
Well, let's look right at the scorecard now. If we go to that, we're at 47-42 for Republicans. And that doesn't tell the whole story because we know that there are going to be seats that Republicans are going to pick up that are safe seats here that are not factored into this. So when you look at our checkmark graphic, we've got Republicans with five pickups now, that just one short of that majority, with Colorado now being called. Of course, Georgia's still out, but like we're seeing, if that Georgia number holds and you have someplace like Iowa go Republican or wind up with Alaska later on tonight, then there's your sixth seat without even thinking about Louisiana on December 6th. If we look at how Cory Gardner won in Colorado, one of the bellwether counties we've been talking about is Jefferson County. And Jefferson County is a Denver suburb, Collar County, right outside Denver. And here we saw that Cory Gardner won 48, or is winning 48, 46% of the vote. And you see in 2008, Mark Udall won 53-42 to help him win there. President Obama won that county 51-46, and that matched his overall total at 51-46. And in 2010, when Michael Bennett won the state very narrowly, he won that county 48-46, and he won overall in the state 48-46 as well. So you can see there, watching those Denver suburbs, Mark Udall didn't appear to be able to get out enough of that kind of vote to be able to turn the tide here. And that county told us where this was going. Judy, back to you.
Thanks, Domenico. Let's turn right now to Stu Rothenberg and Amy Walter. Amy, you're looking not only, I know, at Colorado, which your Republicans are cheering about, a pickup for them. We've now, as Domenico just said, five out of the six seats the Republicans need to win. What should Republicans be feeling good about even before they know tonight about whether they get that sixth pick, that sixth seat that they need to take over control?
Well, the fact that they were able to win in a state like Colorado does suggest that this is not just going to be one of those red state victories. You know, we knew going into this that Republicans could win control of the Senate just by winning six of the seven reddest states. And we now are going to move into Iowa. The polls close there. And just looking at the exit polls, Joni Ernst is doing well among the group she needed to do well among, that she did not win among women, at least, again, these are early exits, but holding her own, losing women by only 4 points, doing very well among men, and doing very well among older voters, which, again, in Iowa, bigger constituency. So I think that they have some good things to look forward to in a state like Iowa. And again, the fact that they were able to win these governor's races, I know we were talking about the Senate, but winning governor's races in these purplish, bluish states, Florida, Wisconsin, another good takeaway for Republicans tonight. So it's not just a red state kind of night.
Stu, do you see any good news tonight for a Democrat? What do you see that if you're a Democrat, you think, okay, we can do something with this?
Well, Jean Shaheen in New Hampshire held on. Gwen Graham in Florida won a very competitive congressional district. Democrats are hoping to hang on in some of these other states like Iowa, North Carolina, although, frankly, some of the numbers suggest it might be difficult in one or both states. But I think if you're a Democrat, I think there's an easy answer here. And I don't mean what you'll hear from some Democratic politicians, the Koch brothers bought the election. No, you'll hear that, but I don't think that was decisive. What is decisive is who voted. And Republicans and Democrats are going to say, well, look, this was a midterm. We did a good job getting some folks out to vote, African Americans in Georgia and North Carolina. Sure, we did some of that. But just wait till we get a better electorate. If you're a Democrat, I think you're going to have to fall back on, because there was a breeze. It's looking like a stiff breeze here, mm-hmm. considering how close the Virginia race was, that what we're seeing early from Iowa and even North Carolina, where I thought Kagan was in pretty good shape when I saw some early numbers. Now I'm not so sure. So if you're a Democrat, you say, yeah, this was that election. Now we go to the next one.
But Amy, we know the Democrats put a lot of money into turnout. I mean, they were trying to raise money like crazy so they could get right. that vote out, because they knew that was their hope.
Well, as a Republican said to me, this was even a couple of weeks ago, you know, it's tough to win on turnout when you're losing on message. And that's been the big problem for Democrats this entire election, is that the message, the mood has been very pessimistic, that voters not feeling particularly good about anything, especially the economy. I mean, if there was one thing that Democrats thought they were going to be able to talk about this election, it was the economy is improving. It's even improved since 2012. People not buying it, not believing it. And so what you had to do if you're a Democrat is try to turn people out simply because they were Democrats, as opposed to giving them a reason to go out and vote. And that is very, very, very tough to do.
Well, we know Democrats are going to be spending some time, and Republicans, looking at what went well and what didn't go well. And we're still waiting for more results to come in. Gwen?
It's a fascinating time. But before anyone even cast their ballot today, this election was already one for the record books. Political director Domenico Montanaro explains.
Let's start with this big number, $4 billion. That's how much has been spent on this election. It's more money than any midterm in history. Just how much money is that? That could buy 40 million school textbooks, put 33,000 kids through college all 4 years, or pay for 13,000 average-priced American homes. Or if space is more your thing, you could take 40 trips to the moon. It's the most money ever spent on congressional races in any campaign, even in presidential years. About $3 billion of that money was spent by the candidates and parties supporting them. The other $1 billion was spent by outside groups. So where did all that money go? Staffing, get out the vote efforts, and of course, TV ads, which have been overwhelmingly negative.
Mary Landrieu doesn't represent you. She represents Barack Obama.
Mitch McConnell skipped hundreds of committee meetings on agriculture, veterans, energy, and defense.
Chew on this. In the last 2 weeks of this campaign, about $20 million a day has been spent on TV ads. Oh, and by the way, this isn't even all the money that's been spent. There's at least another $100 million in so-called dark money that goes unreported.
Now back to Lisa Desjardins, our political editor, because I want to talk to her a little bit about one of the issues that gets overlooked sometimes on a night like tonight, which is what happens next. Right. If, as we now see, 5 of the 6 Senate seats are going to Republicans, if there's a chance of Republican power taking over, what is it they plan to do with this? What is on the agenda?
I spent a lot of time in the last week, Gwen, trying to really tap into the minds of Republicans, especially on the Senate side. There have been a lot of very quiet and careful meetings to try and plan out this strategy. They didn't want to assume that they were going to take over, but obviously Republicans knew this was a very strong possibility. still hasn't happened yet. But if it happens, Republicans are talking about some things our viewers will be very familiar with, the Keystone Pipeline. That's something where they think they can get enough Democratic votes to help them in the Senate get past that 60-vote threshold. That is really the question mark here. Republicans can lead and certainly have plenty of oversight hearings, go after the president with rhetoric, but what can they actually get done? Keystone Pipeline is one. Another, Gwen, the medical device tax. That's something that affects a lot of people. We're talking about hip replacements, stents. The manufacturers have to pay that tax right now. It's part of the Affordable Care Act, and it's something that a lot of Democrats don't like as well. I want to also mention something a little bit off the issues track. Who comes into power with Republicans especially? A lot of folks might not realize it will especially be good for the state of Alabama. Alabama's two senators are poised to take over some prominent committees. Senator Sessions would take over the budget committee, Senator Shelby on banking. We'd see kind of some rising of the South in the ranks of the Senate if the GOP takes over.
You know, and Domenico, I want to ask you a little bit about some of the races we have outstanding tonight, especially governor's races. We still don't know what's happening in Connecticut or Maryland, which is surprisingly close, or Kansas, Georgia, Illinois, Maine, Colorado.
Yeah, and these are a lot of places, obviously, with Democratic senators. And, you know, when you look at Maryland, for example, you know, polling locations, very light turnout in a lot of places where Anthony Brown, who's the lieutenant governor, should have done very well. And a lot of people complaining that they didn't see much of him during this campaign. You know, if he did win, if he were able to win Anthony Brown, he would be the only black governor in the country because Deval Patrick in Massachusetts is retiring. So, you know, an interesting race there. And then you in Connecticut, other places, you've seen the unemployment rate and some hard decisions, budgetary, that Governor Malloy has had to make that really have impacted his standing. And he's in a rematch with the former ambassador to Ireland, Tom Foley.
Maybe it's because I'm a former State House reporter. I always find governor's races so interesting. Thanks a lot, right, Domenico. Judy?
And we were just hearing Lisa talk about Gwen was asking Lisa about what the Republicans are going to do if they do win control of the Senate. Just so happens this past weekend, I was in Kentucky covering the Senate race that Republican Mitch McConnell won tonight. If his party picks up one more seat from the Democrats, he will likely be the majority leader. I asked him about how he will work as the leader with the president. Here's some of what he had to say.
If the Senate changes hands, you become majority leader. Is it mainly then about overturning the policies of the Obama administration?
It's a combination of things. First of all, we need to look for areas of potential agreement. The president, for example, has called for trade agreements. I wish he would send them up. Most of my members are in favor of trade agreements. We think America benefits from free trade. The president has talked about how outrageous it is that we have the highest corporate tax rate in the industrialized world. I agree. Now let's get about changing the tax code. So the first thing to do, I think, is to look for areas of potential agreement. Remember, Reagan never had the House in 8 years. Clinton didn't have the House or the Senate for six of his 8 years. There were some significant bipartisan agreements in both those periods. Reagan and O'Neill saved Social Security for a generation, did last comprehensive tax reform. Bill Clinton and the Republicans did welfare reform and actually balanced the budget. So, look, I think the first thing to do is look for areas of agreement. There are things we don't agree on, and we will pass a budget that he probably will not like. We will try to restrict the executive branch overreach that's been going on through the spending process, which he will not like. So I think it will be a mixture, hopefully, of some areas of cooperation, but there are differences, yes.
You've been very critical of the administration's policies. You've talked about the damage that they've done to the economy. So what would you, specifically, what would you undo that they've done?
Well, let me tell you what I'd like to undo. It is the war on coal, which has created a depression in my state and is sending utility rates up all over them. We'd like to restrict the Environmental Protection Agency from being able to pursue these policies that have created a depression here in my state. That's very right at the top of my list.
And what about the health care law, the Affordable Care Act?
Well, I think if I could get rid of this monstrosity, believe me, I would. I know who's in the White House for the next 2 years. What we're certainly going to be doing is voting on repealing the medical device tax, which 79 out of 100 senators have voted for in the past. That includes a lot of Democrats trying to restore the 40-hour work week, which Obamacare has destroyed, and try to get rid of the individual mandate, all of which are hugely unpopular with the American people.
And what I found most interesting about what he had to say is that he started out by talking about areas of agreement that he, as you heard him say, he's going to look at trade policy. He's going to look at tax reform. That doesn't necessarily mean Republicans and the White House and Democrats are going to see eye to eye on the details. But it was fascinating to me, Mark, that the man who could be the majority leader in the Senate, the leader of the Republicans, is talking about working with the president. Why is he doing that?
Well, I think that's smart to do. I mean, people don't want rancor. That's one thing that came through loud and clear from voters on both sides. They wanted Washington to be less polarized, to work closer together. I thought that it was interesting. He praised Speaker O'Neill and President Reagan, and then he spoke about the President Reagan passing the tax reform. He just talked not about tax reform comprehensively. He talked about the corporate tax rate was where his focus is. And I think there's a difference between that and what, for example, Dave Camp, the outgoing chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, proposed an overarching bill, which would involve closing loopholes, not just closing, cutting down the corporate tax.
Did it strike anybody as interesting, or did it strike you as interesting, Judy, in talking to him, that, you know, when he started by saying, I believe in agreement, and he immediately veered into all the things they were going to disagree on. And this is after a campaign in which every Republican candidate in the country ran ads, identical ads that said so-and-so, Democrat X, voted with Obama 98% of the time. It seems interesting to talk about agreement now.
Before we go any further, we have a projection debate in the state of Georgia. We have the man, this is not a pickup for Republicans, but Republicans will be very happy about this because David Perdue, who is the cousin of the former governor, Sonny Perdue, has defeated the daughter of former Georgia Senator Sam Nunn, Michelle Nunn. David Perdue, the projected winner in the state of Georgia. Those polls closed at 8 o'clock over 2.5 hours ago. So that means it was closer than in fact, we knew it was going to be a little bit close, Gwen, based on the polls. All of us are interested to see just how close it was. All right, Republicans, I'm told we need to keep moving here.
We looked at several of these closely fought Senate races. Jeffrey Brown has this look at some of our recent coverage.
Anyone watching the fate of the U.S. Senate this year likely found themselves looking west of the Mississippi. Iowa and Colorado were two of the most hard-fought contests, and in both cases, women and women's issues loomed large. Gwen Ifill flew to Denver. We'll have her story in a few minutes. First, Judy Woodruff's report on the Iowa Senate race.
If you love college football, the place to be in Iowa this past weekend was Iowa City, the home of the University of Iowa Hawkeyes, as they hosted the Iowa State Cyclones. The beer flowed freely, and over 100,000 exuberant fans jostled, ready to cheer or jeer at the slightest provocation. It's the biggest and oldest rivalry in this state, and it played out as another newer rivalry is reaching a full boil. The contest for the open U.S. Senate seat here, being vacated by 30-year Democratic veteran Tom Harkin. It's a battle between four-term Democratic Congressman Bruce Braley and Joni Ernst, until just a few months ago, a little-known Republican state senator from a town of just over 5,000, who splashed onto the political scene with a TV ad touting her experience growing up on an Iowa farm.
I'm Joni Ernst. I grew up castrating hogs on an Iowa farm. So when I get to Washington, I'll know how to cut pork.
Another TV spot stressed how comfortable the National Guard Lieutenant Colonel, who served in Iraq, is shooting a gun.
Joni doesn't miss much.
All this endeared her to conservative voters, who catapulted her to an impressive 56% win in a field of 5 Republicans. Since her primary victory in early June, however, she's put less emphasis on her strong anti-abortion and gun rights views and reworded the slogan on her website, Mother Soldier Conservative, to Mother Soldier Independent Leader. Ernst herself, an Iowa State grad who said she was staying neutral on this big game day, downplays the change in tone.
It's a different challenge, but what we have to do is compare and contrast between myself and the congressman, and I stand for Iowa and what's good for Iowans. We have done very well here as a state, and I believe our federal government needs to emulate Iowa. Congressman Braley is part of Washington, D.C. bureaucracy. It doesn't work for Iowa.
Iowa's Republican Governor Terry Branstad, who appears to be sailing to re-election to his sixth term in that office, is campaigning hard for Ernst, who surprised Democrats and pulled even with Braley.
Did you like the castrating hogs ad?
I loved it. I grew up on the farm holding hogs that the veterinarian castrated as well. But that's the kind of stuff that we farm kids do, and working long hours, and not too many women. Our lieutenant colonels in the National Guard have combat experience. So, you know, we've never elected a woman, but this is a woman that I think can serve Iowa well.
The selling point that Iowa has never before elected a woman to Congress works with some voters, but not others.
To me, in these elections, oftentimes the women are the swing portion of the vote, and I think voting for a woman would be attractive to them.
Well, it'd be wonderful, right, but I just wouldn't vote for someone just because they're a woman.
Some say they like her because she represents something different.
First of all, Harkin, I would say, has done a good job. I'm not sure the candidate on his side is the one that's going to make any changes in Washington, so I would take the newcomer.
But there are strong opinions against her as well, especially on the stances she's taken on issues like Social Security, abortion, and contraception.
From a woman's perspective, I don't agree on what she says, especially with abortion and then the whole no abortion with rape or incest, and I don't agree with that at all.
The intensity in the race reflects the fact that this is the first time in 40 years that Iowa has had a wide-open race for the U.S. Senate with no incumbent on the ballot. Add to that the stakes. The fact that the U.S. Senate literally hangs in the balance. As a result, the National Democratic and Republican parties are leaving nothing to chance. Outside groups are pouring in millions of dollars, and the candidates themselves are under extra pressure to perform well and to energize the party faithful. High-profile Republicans such as Marco Rubio, Rand Paul, and Sarah Palin have all come to Iowa to campaign for Ernst.
Hey, guys.
And this weekend, Hillary and Bill Clinton showed up at Senator Harkin's last annual steak fry celebration to thank him and put in a pitch for Democrat Bruce Braley.
In just 50 days, Iowans have a choice to make. A choice and a chance. A choice between the guardians of gridlock and the champions of shared opportunity and shared prosperity. A chance to elect a senator who knows that women should be able to make our own health care decisions.
If Ernst's Achilles heel is her very conservative track record, for Braley, it's some controversies he's created. He seemed to denigrate Iowa's other U.S. Senator, Charles Grassley, as a farmer from Iowa who never went to law school. Braley apologized to Grassley and says he has put the incident behind him. He bores in instead on what his campaign calls his opponent's out of the mainstream views.
My challenge in this race has always been to make sure that the voters of Iowa understand the clear choices between us in this Senate race on issues that affect Iowa's economy. I voted for a 5-year farm bill. I worked 3 years and worked with Republicans to pass it. She said she would have voted against it.
Besides the farm bill and ethanol subsidies, voters bring up Social Security and Medicare. Longtime Iowa political reporter O.K. Henderson says issues are at play. But in this state with a low unemployment rate, she believes the race may turn on something else.
When it boils down to it, this is a character race right now. They're both trying to cast the other as the kind of a character that you just can't trust in Washington.
Both campaigns and outside groups are contributing to the character war with spots like these.
Joni Ernst would be another Tea Party vote in the Senate. Ernst would privatize Social Security.
Bruce Braley, trial lawyer and Washington politician, supports Obamacare.
Democratic strategist Jeff Link insists Braley's early gaffes in the campaign won't stick in voters' minds.
I think we've had about 12 commercials that have used the clip of the Grassley comment, and I don't think there's a person in Iowa that doesn't know about it. I hope they understand that he has a strong commitment to Iowa agriculture. That's why the Iowa corn growers endorsed him. And we're still in the position that we are, where she is viewed more unfavorably than he is.
Braley's campaign is making sure of that with spots of its own.
But I just don't trust Joni Ernst.
She supports a plan to eliminate Medicare's guaranteed benefit.
Republican strategist David Kochel, who's advising the Ernst campaign, insists the negative spots Braley has aired against her won't have the desired effect.
Her views are very much in the mainstream of Iowa. Yes, she's pro-life, but many Iowans are pro-life. It's not the issue that she is primarily focused on. I mean, anytime you have $10 million in negative ad spend against you, it's going to make it a little more difficult. But we've been outspent by $2.2 million since the primary. I don't think it will be that way for the rest of the campaign.
Kochel is overseeing an advertising strategy that pivots Ernst's message away from her most conservative views to more moderate ones.
I care about protecting Social Security for seniors like my mom and dad.
But Democrats are betting they can overwhelm what they call Ernst's centrist shift by reminding voters of her long-held right-wing positions. Retiring Senator Tom Harkin, who's raising money and campaigning hard for Braley, says he's counting on Iowans wanting to keep a balance in their Senate representation.
Senator Grassley, I don't agree philosophically. We don't agree on big issues. We don't vote alike on a lot of national issues. But when it comes to Iowa, we work together. And so I think Iowans have benefited from that kind of balance. If Joni Ernst wins, that balance gets upset. If Bruce Braley's there, then they keep that balance between Republicans and Democrats.
But feeling Republicans breathing down their necks, Democrats are doubling down on this year's Get Out the Vote effort, which starts in just 9 days with the opening of absentee voting.
I'm a little sweaty. How are you?
At first blush, it may seem that Colorado's Senate race between incumbent Mark Udall and Congressman Cory Gardner has boiled down to two men fighting over women's issues.
Congressman Cory Gardner's history promoting harsh anti-abortion laws is disturbing.
That's Senator Udall's campaign. Senator Udall is a social issues warrior. He wants to talk about nothing else. It's something that they campaigned on 4 years ago when Michael Bennett was running in Colorado. It won then. They did it again in 2012, and so they think that same playbook will win again in 2014.
He's saying that I'm a social issues warrior. In fact, he is. I'm an economic issues warrior. You talk to women, this is about economics. It's also about respect. And Colorado's fiercely independent. We're libertarians, and we respect our freedoms. And we think government, above all, should not be involved in those really private decisions.
But the critical Election Day question may be, which women are they speaking to?
You guys can canvass the doors together.
Are they speaking to women like Kathy Alderman, who's been campaigning against an anti-abortion ballot initiative?
They can vote for somebody who supports women and supports women's ability to access the health care services they need, versus somebody who is willing to limit that access and has spent an entire political career trying to limit that access.
Yeah, let's do it. Should we get it?
Or are they appealing to women like Brianna Johnson, a mother of three who describes herself as pro-life?
It's hard when a group of women is coming on and claiming to speak for the entire population of women because, yeah, I don't relate to that. They say, you know, Cory Gardner is too extreme for women of Colorado. Well, that's not what I believe, and that immediately alienates me.
64-year-old Udall, who is just completing his first term in the Senate, is one of a handful of Democratic incumbents under sustained political fire this year.
Oh, you bet.
His nemesis, a 40-year-old two-term congressman who says the country and Colorado are due for a midterm, mid-course correction that only a Republican Senate majority can deliver.
Are you ready to make Harry Reid a footnote in history?
Yeah!
Hi, Senator.
how are you?
Udall's predicament is especially perilous because of Colorado's reputation as a notoriously unpredictable state. President Obama has won twice here, but many of the state's voters see themselves as outliers who are as likely to legalize marijuana as expand oil exploration.
I think the people of Colorado are very independent. And I think as soon as they feel like they're getting pigeonholed or labeled as more Democratic or more Republican, they're going to switch. They're going to move. They don't like being told who they are.
It's time to get the vote out.
For voters throughout the West, the name Udall is a known quantity. Mark Udall's father, Morris, was a senator from Arizona. And he also has two cousins in the Senate now, Utah Republican Mike Lee and New Mexico Democrat Tom Udall.
I'm a mountain climber. You all know that. You don't schmooze your way up a mountain. You don't trash talk your way up a mountain. You just climb the doggone thing. So this is a mountain we're climbing. Let's go climb it. I'm proud to be your United States Senator. I look forward to a very successful election night.
Amen.
But Gardner treats Udall's political history as a liability.
He is the Senate. 18 years in politics, and he's got two cousins who are senators, too.
Ads like this have transformed Udall's re-election bid into a bitterly contested toss-up.
My dad, well, he sells tractors.
The Denver Post and the Colorado.
Last week, Gardner won the surprise endorsement of the state's biggest newspaper, which derided the incumbent for running what it described as a one-issue campaign.
Well, I think you stand up for people's privacy.
Udall shrugs off the hometown rebuke.
If the Denver Post doesn't think women's reproductive rights are important, that's their decision, but that's an important part of my campaign.
Norman Provisor, a political science professor at Metropolitan State University in Denver, says Gardner has another advantage, a more affable approach to conservative politics.
He's one of the more conservative members of the House, but he comes across as kind of a Tea Party member without the steam. Instead of steam, he has a smile. So he's kind of put a kinder, gentler face on some policies that many people think of as very harsh.
Thomas Unterwagner, who stopped off at a weekend farmer's market in the midst of a 40-mile bike ride, is supporting Udall. He thinks the senator is in a tight race because of where he works, Washington.
I think most basically the problem is I think they blame whoever's in office currently, the incumbent, and whether they're economically doing well or not, they still blame the incumbent, so for some reason.
Adding to the uncertainty this year is this new twist. Colorado is joining Oregon and Washington State in sending every voter a ballot to cast by mail, a shift that could determine the outcome as well as what it means to get out the vote.
We were just letting voters know that the ballots are coming in this.
Both parties say the campaign ground game, door knocking, phone calling, debating, could make the difference in an election when the polling place comes to you.
Put two first-class stamps on it and send it back in the mail.
But voter after voter we talked to said they are exasperated by the tone of a campaign that has cluttered the airwaves with negative advertising, paid for by the candidates and by outside groups who support them.
Udall hasn't changed Washington. It's changed him.
They go after one another's personalities, and so sometimes I tend to tune out, you know, to some degree at this time of the year.
I already know what I want and what I think is right, so they're just aggravating.
This Rocky Mountain election also features a running debate about the four E's: education, energy, the environment, and the economy.
How you doing?
But central to the choice between Udall and Gardner, who cleared the Republican field when he decided to enter the race, is whether the victory will tip control of the Senate to the GOP. Is your campaign about defeating Mark Udall, who's the incumbent senator, or trying to get that majority?
I felt that the one way that we could really change the direction this country is heading wasn't by staying in a safe Republican House seat, sending out fancy press releases about legislation that would never see the light of day because of Harry Reid, but it was about changing the majority, about becoming number 51, so that we could actually do something to move this country forward for the people of this nation.
In the end, this is about Colorado and what I've delivered for the state of Colorado.
And yet, the outcome of this race could determine the control of the U.S. Senate.
It certainly could, but my focus has been on making the case to voters here as to what I've done for the state, what I will do in a second term when I'm rehired.
But for many Colorado voters, the problem is neither Udall nor Gardner. It's Washington itself.
I think Congress is such a mess that I don't think anybody's getting what they really want. And I don't really know how to fix it.
Does that mean that you might not vote this time?
Oh, no, I'll vote. I always vote.
The candidates meet in their fifth and final debate on Wednesday.
Iowa and Colorado are not only key to deciding who will control the Senate after today's election, they're also both seen as potential swing states in the 2016 presidential election.